an informational forum on the straw poll ballot question A regarding changing the method commissioners in Queen Anne's County are elected. And I'd like to start by all of us, if you would mind standing and have a pledge of allegiance.
Pledge of allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We are the League of Women Voters of Queen Anne's County, and I am Barbara Sharkey, and honored to be the current president of the league. I want to remind you, the League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization that promotes political responsibility through informed and active participation of citizens in their government. And I'd like to start by telling you a little bit about the history and the process for determining the current method of electing county commissioners. This information was provided to us by Barbara Obert, who was chair of the 2001 commission. Before 2002, three commissioners comprised the Board of County Commissioners, and they could reside anywhere in the county. The current method of electing commissioners was the result of a two-year process. In 2000, a straw poll was placed on the ballot for citizens to vote on A, whether to expand the Queen Anne's Board of Commissioners from three elected commissioners to five elected commissioners, and B, whether to establish a residency requirement. Citizens chose to expand the Board of Commissioners to five and to establish a residency requirement to ensure representation from across the county. Then in 2001, an 11-person citizens commission was appointed by the county to evaluate the potential methods by which a five-person Board of Commissioners would be elected and to make a recommendation. The commission was diverse demographically by political party, geographically across the county, and by background. Their evaluation included population, maps, demography, interviews of counties with other structures, election laws, and other variables. Many methods were considered, including election by district, election by all citizens, five districts with no at-large representative, four districts with an at-large representative, subregions of Kent Island and the mainland, etc. The report recommending the current method of electing county commissioners was submitted by the commission in late 2001, and the current method for electing Queen Anne's County commissioners was adopted for the 2002 election. And tonight, our panel consists of two participants that are for and also two that are against the approval of changing the method they are elected. So I'll introduce you tonight. The participants tonight that are for the change are Jim Moran, Queen Anne's County at-large commissioner, Charlie Rhodes, a member of the Churchill Town Commissioners, and participants that are against the change are Steve Wilson, who is a Queen Anne's County Commissioner, District 2, and Jack Broderick, who is the president of the Kent Island Heritage Society. Our moderator is Gwen Schultz. She's a member of the League of Women Voters of Queen Anne's County, and she was actually a founding member of the Queen Anne's County League of Women Voters. And she served on the board for many years and as president also. So Ms. Schultz will now take over the forum and explain to you the rules and expectations. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Hi. Before I get started, I just want to take a moment to introduce our two timers, Jackie Carter and Pat Jameson, sitting right up here. We'll be putting up 15-second signs and stop signs for our presenters, as well as for those of you that do come up to the microphone and ask questions. We'll be making sure we can kind of keep the flow of this evening's forum going smoothly so you can all get to your dinners if you haven't already eaten. But it's going to be a good night tonight. I'll walk through the agenda. We're going to be starting out with each of our participants stating their position on the issue and then giving reasons for that. They'll be getting 3 minutes each. We'll then have four prepared questions, and those are on the back of your agenda here. And I'll be reading those, and then each of our participants will have 1.5 minutes to respond. And after that, we'll be moving on to audience questions. And then at the end of it, each of our participants will have 2 minutes in order to summarize their position. So before we get started, I'll take a moment to actually read the question as it appears on the ballot. And you're welcome to follow along. It is also in a copy of your paper here. So the question is, do you favor changing the method of selection of 4 of the 5 members of the Queen Anne's County Board of County Commissioners from the current method of being elected at large by the voters of Queen Anne's County, with one residing in each election district, to a new method where each of the 4 members is elected by only the voters of the district in which the member resides, and the 5th member is elected at large and may reside in any district of the county? So that's the question that they're responding to. So then at this time, what I'd like to do is ask each of the participants to state their position on the issue and give the reasons. And we've got a set order for both the state position and all the questions. We'll be kind of rotating as to who responds first to the questions. So for this first session, we're going to start out with Jim Moran, followed by Steve Wilson, then Charlie Rhodes, and Jack Broderick.
Well, thank you. First, I'd like to say thank you to the League of Women Voters for putting on a second forum on the issue of voting by districts. I am in favor of voting by districts, and we're only going to be about an hour and a half, so I'm going to keep it short and sweet because I'd like to get to the questions. If you want to hear my opening statements, watch the last video. That's it. There we go.
I haven't thought of what to say yet. No, I'm not going to do what Mr. Moran did. I'm strongly against this, and strongly against it for reasons that I'd like to make clear right from the beginning. Right now, what we have is a system of cooperative government in which all the commissioners work together to share the bounty of taxes and the burden of taxes amongst the citizens. And that changing that system from one that is basically cooperative to one that's competitive is not a good idea. It's not even nearly a good idea. And I think these gentlemen have a considerable hurdle to and hill to climb in demonstrating to you why reducing 5 of your votes down to 2 is a greater representation and greater voice for you, the public. This evening, a point I'm going to particularly stress because it got lost up in the last debate, was I asked up there, what we have an actual way to test whether the government has been working well or not. And the way we test it is this. We look back in history and see how well has the system that we now have working. And the system has worked sufficiently well that I wasn't able to see any particular pattern of inequities, injustices, or preferences from one district to another. Even over years, everything has worked sufficiently well that there's never been a clamor that one district was favored over another. And in order to make, to sort of lock in my position and feel that I'd done a good job, I then asked a number of people I knew, ex-county commissioners, and then I went to the staff. And of the staff, uniformly, and the staff is the distributors of the goods and services of the county, it was generally or completely agreed that they could not think of a single instance in which one district had been asked to be favored or was preferentially treated. Now, when you have a system that isn't just a sort of theoretical discussion, like these guys are trying to promote a theoretically better idea, I have a proof by test that this system has worked very well for a number of years because I don't have a pattern of misdistribution. That's the main thing. We're not here about personalities. We're here about fairness and representation. That's my point.
Yes, ma'am. thank you as well for the League of Women Voters holding this second forum. It's really appreciated, and I think it's much needed. My name is Charlie Rhodes. I'm 61 years of age. I'm a lifelong resident of Queen Anne's County. I attended and graduated from Queen Anne's County Public Schools in 1973, 2 years before Mr. O'Donnell. We were in school together, believe it or not. I've served approximately 40 years as a law enforcement officer, and I was elected to the Churchill Town Commission in 1995, and I still serve today. I completed 21 years, and I've started my 8th three-year term. It's a volunteer position, and as I've stated before, it's much like being a volunteer fireman. It's a lot of work and no pay. My position, and let me back up, I'm also a member and a past president of the Council of Governments, which includes the 8 incorporated municipalities and Queen Anne's County commissioners, of which Mr. Moran is their representative from the county government. I strongly support this nonpartisan initiative, and as well, the Council of Governments does as well, and we have taken 2 unanimous votes over the past year, and we all strongly support it. And more importantly, I support the citizens' right to voice their opinion, like we're doing tonight, and hopefully you'll do it at the ballot box on November the 8th. And as such, I testified along with Mr. Moran and Councilman Sigler from Centerville Town Council before the Maryland Legislature on Delegate Ahrens' bill before the House, and the bill was also supported by Senator Hershey before the Senate. And just to let you folks know, in the Senate, or correction, the House, the vote total was 138-0 on March 26th. And the state Senate vote was 41-0 on April the 8th, to give you the right to speak. Conversely, as I look around the room, there were people there here that testified, signed up and testified against that. And quite frankly, I didn't understand it then, and I'm not sure I do now, as to why anybody, an elected official, would oppose your right to speak on this issue. But having said that, reasons for support, we believe if in fact that this measure passes and the commissioners take action on it, it will create some continuity in office by our county commissioners, your board of directors for the business of Queen Anne's County, which is big business. It's a big, big business. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm Jack Broderick from Kent Island, Chester. Thank you to the League of Women Voters for the invitation to speak here tonight, for setting up this panel. And thank you to our folks who are out watching this on TV. Thanks to all of you who came today. I am strongly opposed to this proposal. I really do think it would be a diminishment of our ability to hold our elected officials accountable. Queen Anne's County commissioners have 2 very important governmental functions. They exercise the legislative power within the county and the executive power. We don't have checks and balances in our form of government. Why I would want to, as a citizen, why I would want to relinquish my ability to hold my elected officials, both executive and legislative officials, accountable for the laws and the decisions and the actions they take in control of my life. Why I would want to give up that ability, I can't fathom. We have discussed this at our previous panel, and I'm sure there'll be many discussions in the next week, month, I hope. I participated about 25 years ago on a panel of citizens, a commission that looked at this issue of whether we ought to go to five. Our group at that time recommended against any change at all. We stayed with three. 25 years ago, that worked quite well. There was another one that came a couple years after that. Al Helfenbein, I believe, chaired it. They made the same recommendation. When Barbara's group met 15 years ago, I worked very closely with Barbara on that. I wasn't appointed on the commission, but I worked right along and had some input into it. I think they came up with a very good recommendation. It was a result of, as the statement said in the beginning, a very long, a very diversified, countywide, bipartisan effort. It gave us what we have today. That's four county commissioners have to be from a specific district, one at large. All of us get the vote for who those commissioners are. They all need to be accountable and understand all the issues throughout the county, and all of us citizens get to hold them accountable for the decisions they make in the county. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. At this time, we're going to shift to the prepared questions that are on the back of your agenda. And I'll be reading each of these, and then each of our participants have 1.5 minutes in order to respond. So the order for this first question will be starting out with Mr. Wilson, then Mr. Moran, then Mr. Broderick, and then Mr. Rhodes. So the first question is the current system of electing county commissioners broken to the point that it needs fixing?
Well, I answered that in the opening statement. It is not. It's not broken a bit. It's working well. The distributions and fairness have existed over the last years. They continue to exist. What's threatened here is a change in the motivation of elected officials, because when instead of being elected by all the citizens, you're only elected by your district, you become a representative and sort of pork barrel guarantor of your district. This is not a good motivation for commissioners. They should be motivated to see the width and breadth of all the citizens and stick to that. As to Mr. Charlie, who has been my friend for 40 years, assertion that continuity is an issue. When you have good commissioners, you have continuity. The great way to, the great way you have to elect good people, if they're good, keep them. If you don't, throw them out. We've thrown out a lot of people who weren't great, and that hadn't been a bad idea. So I'm arguing against that point that continuity has been an enemy of anything in the county. For one part, it was argued in the last meeting that certain things like the sewer or the courthouse didn't get done because of continuity. That, in fact, is not true. The sewer, during George's term, was he couldn't build a collection system because he didn't have a plant. Gene didn't want a collection system because he didn't want more houses. Arntz couldn't do it because he had no money. The county went broke. So that continuity argument is a flawed argument, and I still want to know, what is it that's happened in the last years that points to any unfairness or inequality or lack of efficiency of the system we have?
Okay, Mr. Moran.
Okay, so let me see if I can answer your concern there, Commissioner Wilson. Is the system broken? It needs serious repairing. It might be working for District 4, not a problem, but there's been two times now that everyone said, hold our commissioners accountable. If you don't like them, vote them out. Well, that's what this is all about. If you're in District 1, 2, and 3, and you place your vote like they did in the last election, they didn't throw anybody out. They didn't get the people they wanted because they were trumped by District 4. And this is what this is about. This is about representation. And this, you know, I'm glad we've heard the word pork barrel, because here it comes again. And commissioners have very little amount of money that's left over, we call surplus, which could be pork barrel, to use. And if you're not an honorable person and you get elected, then you're going to do not honorable things. So I don't think that somebody in District 1 or District 2 or District 3 or District 4 that votes for their representative will vote somebody in that's less honorable. I mean, that's just ludicrous. I think that because the system and the voting and the projects that work now, they'll work in the future. But at least you know that District 1, when they want someone to represent them, they're going to vote, and the majority of those voters are going to get the person they want to represent them, as is in District 2 and in District 3 and in District 4. And then you still have an at-large. And, you know, so I think that, you know, this portion about accountability, we want to hold everybody accountable. Well, how can District 1, 2, and 3 hold them accountable? Because when they vote, their vote gets trumped by District 4. So that's what this is about, and I think that this it is a fair question, and I don't know what everybody's so afraid of. I mean, District 4 will have the same amount of power as District 1, as District 2, and District 3. I mean, everybody has their own representative. I don't know what the fear is about going to a system where you have your own representative, but we're going to find out. Thank you.
I don't think it's broken right now. It's not perfect, that's for darn sure. I think by reducing our ability to elect all five of our commissioners, it would become broken. I think the most important part of this is that our commissioners exercise both executive and legislative power. It just makes no sense to not be able to elect three of the five people that are both your executive and your legislators. I don't think it's broken, and I hope we don't fix something that's not broken.
Thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
Yes, as I stated at the last meeting, I see this as an evolution of the process started about 16 years ago. However, since that process began, of the three previous boards of commissioners, 17 county commissioners that have served, only one has been returned to office by the voters. Only one. And again, as I stated earlier, I'm here representing the COG as well as the town of Churchill. And that creates some issues between the towns and the county when you're in negotiations. And some of you folks down here may ask, what's that about? Because there are no incorporated municipalities down here in District 4. Well, we have certain responsibilities that we do have to negotiate with the county about, such as their designated growth areas, our joint planning areas, which we've worked hand in hand with the county. During those negotiations, we've had agreements. We're moving in that direction. Then all of a sudden, we have a county election, and you're dealing with all new people that may have different ideas. So it takes time, and it takes effort, and time is money in this game, as everybody knows. And other issues, such as the master water and sewer plant. The folks down here on Kent Island are lucky to have a county government-owned sewer and water plant. When you get north of Graysonville, the only sewer and water up there, none of it's county-owned, it's owned by the municipalities. Centerville has sewer and water, Churchill has sewer, Queenstown has sewer and water, and Southernville has sewer and water. They are owned and operated by the citizens of those towns. So there are some different issues there. And having said that, we're impacted when these commissioners turn over like that.
Good, thank you. So the second question is, would there be any negative impact on Queen Anne's County citizens if the change to the method of electing county commissioners as described on the ballot question A was implemented? And the order for this one will be Mr. Rhodes, followed by Mr. Broderick, Mr. Moran, and Mr. Wilson.
I don't see any negative impact. As a matter of fact, I think it would be positive. I think you'd have more candidates possibly run, as campaign costs, in theory, should be cheaper. Anybody that's followed the information that's been publicized will realize there were very high campaign costs during the 2014 county commissioner election. I'd like to say I believe it would be an evolution of the process that we started, and I was involved in that back in 2000. I was the chairman of the Democratic Central Committee, and we're the one that went to Delegate Baker after hearing complaint from the people in District 4. There was a movement back in the 90s by a group down here that wanted to incorporate Stevensville, Chester, because there was a feeling that they weren't being represented by the county commissioners in Centerville. Because at that time, the majority of your commissioners came from Queenstown North. We heard that, we addressed the issue, and we contacted our legislators and got a ballot question. And it's non-binding, just like this, and it passed, and the county commissioners at that time, after the vote, took some action to create what we have now, after there was a committee put together and numerous meetings with citizen input. And I believe it's an evolution of process, and it's needed.
Thank you. Okay, Mr. Braddock?
Yes. I think Charlie described quite well the dilemma that many of us face who don't happen to live in a municipality. He enumerated the local powers that municipalities have over their own lives. Water and sewer, planning and zoning, in some case parks, in one case their own police. They have the ability to make their own decisions at the local level. He also mentioned the sewer down here on Kent Island, the sewer plant. A county facility controlled by county leaders, decisions on the extension of that and the use of that made by county leaders. Again, I think the most negative part of this would be it would take away even more than it would give us less power, less control in District 4 or anywhere else where you're outside of a municipality, where someone else is making the decisions that affect your life. I think it's hard for a municipality to stretch out and understand that aspect of it. Yeah, there was a discussion here in the early 90s about maybe we ought to have our own form of government on the island. Maybe we might be better off. A lot of us didn't quite agree with that at the end. We had trust in the county's ability. I have to say, as I commented the other day, that since this thing has come back up, that discussion is back up on the table again. Folks are not interested in giving up what little power and little accountability they have right now.
Thank you, Mr. Moran.
Okay. And Jack, I totally understand that. I get that. I mean, I get that District 4 doesn't have any municipalities in it, and I don't have a problem with that, and maybe they should incorporate. That might not be a bad idea. And, you know, I think that that's not a bad idea for Stevensville. So with that being said, would there be a negative impact on Queen Anne's County citizens? I don't think so. I think that it would pull in the disenfranchised voters and citizens we have in Districts 1, 2, and 3, knowing that their vote never carries through to fruition. So to me, I think that it would help those three districts, and I understand the concerns of District 4. But the bottom line is one person, one vote, and to get that vote trumped from somebody else. We have 47 senators in the state of Maryland, 47 senators. And you don't vote on every one of them. You know why? Because Baltimore City, Montgomery County, and Prince George's County would trump all your votes. And that's why you vote for your senator that represents your district. And that's why I think the voting by district is a better form, a purer form of government. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Wilson?
Well, Charlie says that this is an evolution. Well, you can evolve the wrong way. Ask the dinosaurs. They evolved right out of business. And the problem we got with this one, as Mr. Moran has pointed out here, that that with continuity, you're likely to be able to carry some things on through. But very often, the change of continuity has resulted from a change in public opinion. We've had periods of time, 10, 20 years, where people wanted more growth, where they wanted less growth, where they wanted a recovery from economic questions. Those changes of opinion have been reflected by changes in the commissioners they voted in. And I think that's exactly what you call good government and representative government. At times, it does thwart the ability of the towns to do something. But let's remember, the towns represent 35% or under 40% of the people in the county. And to give them more power and to disenfranchise the other 60-some percent of the county is not a good idea. It doesn't lead to fairness. And I still haven't heard any list of inequalities, which I continue to ask for, or discrepancies of good government that have occurred from what the system we have now. I'm going to keep up with that.
Okay, thank you. So the third question is, would voting by district for four of the five county commissioners likely reduced turnover in the composition of the Board of Commissioners. And the order is Mr. Broderick, Mr. Rhodes, Mr. Wilson, and then Mr. Moran.
I want to make 2 points. First, I'll answer the question. I don't know whether it'll reduce turnover or not. I think manufacturing a new system just to reduce turnover is a mistake. To me, turnover is something that should be based on merit. It should be based on a commissioner being held accountable and deserving to be reelected. If that commissioner hasn't come through, then turnover is a good thing. Some have elected themselves not to run again for various personal reasons. But again, I think the greater value here is whether that's deserved. That one commissioner that was mentioned, Gene Ransom, he did a great job. He deserved to be reelected. I know Gene, I think he did a really good job. And that's what it comes down to, is deserving not to be turned over. On the other thing about just quick comment, the state level, yeah, they're elected by district senators and delegates, but that's only the legislative branch. We all get to elect the executive. We all get to elect the governor. He doesn't just get elected by one or two independent districts. Don't forget, we're talking both legislative power and executive power here. Thanks.
Okay, Mr. Rhodes?
I believe voting by district would reduce the possibility of turnover in the commission. First of all, you're going to have a smaller district that you're going to run in. You're going to be voted on by your friends and neighbors that know you, and you're going to be representing the district while serving the entire county. And quite frankly, and Jack brings up a good point, some people elected not to run in that previous board, but I would offer that there's a good possibility if they had a smaller district to run in, maybe they would. I mean, this is 370 square miles. This county is 370 square miles. And the majority of the land mass is in District 1 and 2. The population up there is not as dense as it is down here in District 3 as well. But I definitely believe that it would reduce turnover. You'd have people more than likely would rerun after they were elected. And the possibility as well, as I stated earlier, you'd probably have more people to run in the district initially. So I do believe it would reduce the turnover.
Good. Thank you. Mr. Wilson?
I have no idea. It seems to me that part of it is the skill you display while you're in the job. Another part of reducing turnover is there's two parts to getting elected. One is how well you do the job. Another one is how good you are at getting elected. Those are two different, utterly different skill sets. Some people who are good at getting elected and rotten commissioners, and then vice versa. So both those criteria would have to be met. I can't answer the question of whether if you had more continuity would necessarily give you a better, more representative government. I don't see that argument following. There have been lots of governments where really dreadful people got in and stayed there forever, and other times when it was a good idea. And so the argument that more continuity is of itself a good thing is not based on anything I can understand. And so I don't know what the answer is.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Moran?
Will voting by district reduce the turnover? I would say that, I'm on the fence on that also. I agree with you, Mr. Wilson. I think if you do your job and you do it right, but I think that voting by district will definitely help that situation. You're right. And you talk about voting people out, but they don't do their job. Well, in a district, that's loud and clear. I mean, you could do a terrible job for a district, but do a great job for these other districts, and you could still hold that seat not representing that district. So, I mean, that's a double-edged sword. And I also want to go back and address the what Commissioner Wilson said about this gives more power to towns. No, it doesn't. That's ludicrous. I mean, we are four districts, four equal districts, and each district will have the same representation, one person. So it's not, they might be, the towns might be 35%, but there's a lot of county property around that, and a lot of citizens live there. So they're equal districts. And again, you know, getting elected, it is an art. You've got to be a good speaker. You've got to be somebody with some moral character and some values, but also it takes money. And that's one of the reasons we're doing this, to try to level the playing field, because you can walk to every house in a district. It's very difficult to do it in an entire county. So, you know, that's another portion about this, and I'm just going to close by saying the dinosaurs were around for billions of years. I don't know about us humans.
Okay. Now, the next question is, will a change to the election by district as proposed by ballot question A improve the lives of Queen Anne's County citizens in important ways? And the order will be Mr. Moran, followed by Mr. Wilson, and Mr. Rhodes, and Mr. Broderick.
Well, again, and you know, that's, everybody has their own opinion about that. But again, I feel that this will bring more people into the fold of being concerned about what their representative is doing up there. I mean, you know, we're all voted at large. So I could have somebody from District 1 call me and say, you know, what the heck are you doing about X, Y, and Z? And somebody called me from 4, you know, I've got an issue with the drainage ditch. And you could blow them off. You could say pound sand. You could do whatever you want if you're that kind of person, without any recourse on their part. But if you do that once, two, three times in your district, that word's going to get around that, hey, you know, this is an individual that's not following through on my concerns and my needs. So I do think it'll empower those districts that have had, let's face it, voter turnout issues over the years to finally be able to say, okay, I know that when I go to vote, my vote's not going to get trumped. And I think that will make a better place for Queen Anne's County.
Thank you.
Mr. Wilson. Well, Jim says you can walk to all our houses. I can damn near not walk to my own house. Mm-hmm. And that the idea that I can trudge around through 8,000 houses or whatever number it is pretty near laughable. You know, in an election, there are a lot of different things that make people good at getting elected. And everybody's got their own gift. One guy may have good looks and money, silver tongue like Mr. Moran, the best talker in the county as far as I know. And that everybody's got an advantage or a disadvantage. And I think that when you get around to this, it still doesn't answer two questions, one of which is, did this continuity really improve? If we had a continuity, would it really improve the lives of Queen Anne County citizens? What would if we had wonderful commissioners? Sure it would. But is that what has happened or what this will bring? And I think the answer to that is no. And that another question is, it would bring more people in the system. In the last election, am I right, George or Larry, were there 28 or 30 people ran? If we now had 50 people running, would that, you know, that it's almost unimaginable how you sort out that many people. 30 is, look what the Republicans did with 17. Now the county's got 30. I'm not sure that we need more candidates. We need better candidates. But the main point is that the candidates need to represent the whole county, not their little itsy-bitsy district. They need to represent the finances of the county, the health of the county, the well-being of the county. And that's the way the system we have now is working. They haven't answered the question yet on what the list of things that didn't work was. Don't change it.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
Yeah, I believe a change to election by district as proposed by ballot question A would improve the lives of the citizens of Queen Anne's County. As I stated earlier, I think what it'll do, it will engage the electorate, if you will, of each district to become more involved, because they will know, more than likely know, the person that lives and represents their district. Plus, they'll have the ability to keep that person accountable for their district, as well as the way they're represented in the county. And as I think Commissioner Moran indicated, they would be closer to the people in their district right then than they are now, in my view. They'll be the closest, and it's where, as someone said at the last meeting, they're there where the rubber hits the road. They'll understand the problems facing that district and be able to address their issues, as well as represent that group of citizens in county government while representing and serving the entire county.
Okay, Okay, thank you. And then Mr. Broderick?
Again, I have to go back to what I have said before. I know I sound like a broken record, but thanks, Larry. I think it comes down to that very, very simple mathematical equation that's on a couple of those signs out there. You have the ability to hold five people accountable right now. This new proposal, if it goes through, will reduce the ability, diminish our ability to hold five accountable, and you only hold two accountable, whether you know them personally or not. They're still making the very direct decisions that affect your life. And I think it's a mistake.
Okay, well, thank you. Well, that ends the session where we're talking about the prepared questions. In a moment, I'm going to be inviting any of the audience that are interested in asking questions to come up to the podium. We do ask that you come up and speak into the microphone because this is being recorded. Couple of things, just a few ground rules about the questions. So if you do ask a question, please make sure that your question is addressed to all four of our speakers. And then each of the speakers, in a kind of this preset order that I'll read out, will have 2 minutes in order to respond to the question. So when you get up there, please identify yourself and where you live. And then we're asking that you not really take this as an opportunity to get into any specific personal situations, but really kind of ask any questions that you believe are relevant to our entire audience here. And then also refrain from any personal comments. So at that point, you have 1 minute in order to kind of pose your question, and then I'll be asking our speakers to respond. So do we have any folks coming in? So, yep, come on up. And then remember, these are our timers. So you might get a little nudge if you're done over a minute.
Thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you for the time. My name's George Plumbo. I'm a resident of Queenstown, Maryland, and I'm a sitting member of the council over there. And one of the things I heard was that there wasn't a problem with the continuity and there wasn't anything going wrong with the changeover from the commissioners. And as I heard, there were 17 commissioners who changed over in the last number of elections. So I wanted to get some feedback where in my town, we had a situation where we were granted a waiver for development, and then the new commissioners came in, rescinded the waivers, and then a county spent $70,000 of taxpayers' money to rescind that, and then they dropped out of the out of the lawsuit. So I'd like to hear from the commissioners, you know, their theory of where continuity wasn't a factor in that.
Okay, good. So the order for this one will be Mr. Wilson, followed by Mr. Moran, then Mr. Broderick, and then Mr. Rhodes.
I'd be happy to answer the continuity question. If the set of commissioners you started with had been against it, you wouldn't have had that decision to make positively. The idea that commissioners change reflects a change very often in public, deep public opinion as to whether growth, whether development, whether business is something we're trying to encourage or whether we're growing at a faster pace than we think we can absorb in terms of the services. So I think that those changes in continuity are exceptionally democratic and fair, and I know that sometimes they're inconvenient. But democracy is an inconvenient form of government, but it's a good form of government. It represents the people, and that's what I think we're here to do.
Okay, Mr. Moran?
Well, I have a different opinion of that. That's an interesting question. I never even thought about that. But I will say that that does affect. With turnover, that does affect. This is one of those things we're talking about. Something's in the works. Something's going on. And it gets rescinded, okay? It was voted on by three of the five commissioners and approved, and then it was rescinded by the next set of commissioners. Now, had we voted by district the last time, it would not have been rescinded because there would have been two other people sitting up there that would have voted for that or not, wouldn't even come up to vote. So it does make a difference. If we voted by district, we would have never spent $70,000 of taxpayer money in a fight that we should never been in fight for commercial space. Not homes, not houses, not school-age kids, but commercial-based tax. That's it.
Okay, thank you. Then Mr. Broderick?
You know, it's hard to say what any given set of commissioners is going to do. I think in that particular situation, commissioners were leaning in one direction. They lost the election. They went out. They had made a commitment. The commissioners that got elected from the will of the people, all five being elected by all of us, saw it a different way and went in and exercised the rights of democracy and reversed that decision. That's going to happen with changes of public officials. Again, I think those changes will happen based on the will of the people, and that's the way it ought to be.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
Well, I can tell you, based on the comments of this gentleman, that's one of the cruxes of the issue with the towns. I mean, we're independent, incorporated municipalities. And I've been doing this 21 years, and we've had those types of issues arrive over the years with the numerous boards of county commissioners as it relates to towns. As I understand that situation, and we develop these joint planning areas where the town staff and citizens sit down with the county staff and citizens, and the town invests a considerable amount of money and time, which is money, working out this arrangement, have a deal, and then all of a sudden you have five new commissioners come in and undo the deal after all this time and money's been expended. And I can tell you that is really a sore subject with these towns, these municipalities. And Jack, I don't expect you to understand it because you're not there and you don't have any incorporated municipalities down here. But these towns invest a lot of time and money in engineers. We have our own. We have our own attorneys. We have our own planning and zoning commission. And it's not just the commissioners. It's the citizens of that town work in conjunction with the town or the county commissioners and their staff. And it's not the first time it's happened. And that's one of the reasons the towns have issues. And we believe that if, in fact, you have a continuity of government, your county commissioners, and you're not throwing all five out every election, that won't occur.
Okay, thank you. Do we have another question? Yes, gentlemen here.
Thank you, gentlemen, for coming and fielding all these questions. My name is Stan Rudy. I'm a resident of Kent Island. And my question for you is, if you keep in mind that Kent Island is a large percentage of the entire county and is about to become even a larger, Kent Island might hold more than 50% of the county voters. How will this change help Kent Island getting the agendas that we need to have addressed, and how will it help or hurt the rest of the county in getting their needs met? Thanks.
Good, thank you. So the order on this one is Mr. Rhodes, then Mr. Broderick, Mr. Moran, and Mr. Wilson.
Well, I believe if in fact we move forward on the question and we develop the system that's proposed by the question, now, and let me regress, as everybody knows, it's a straw poll. The people get the right to speak. Whatever the vote is, then the current sitting commissioners can take action, not take action, or don't do anything. But if in fact that were to occur, that we moved in that direction, I think Kent Island would be very well represented. As a matter of fact, under federal law, based on population, and as the population grows down here, I think when we looked at this back in early 2000s, the way the districts broke out, under federal law, they're required to have basically the same amount of population. As your population grows down here on the south end, there's a good chance Kent Island could end up with two resident districts. So you're going to be represented, and you're going to be very well taken care of. But, and you'll have two, you've got one, if we keep the same system. You'll have one at large, and then the other two will be spread amongst the other districts based on population. I think Kent Island, as they grow, more than likely will end up with more commissioners based on this system.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Broderick?
I'm not willing to take that chance, Charlie. There's a lot of time in between now and whenever that might happen. Stan, I don't think there is a benefit to Kent Island residents in this scenario, the new scenario, for reasons I said before. It's a matter of holding your decision makers accountable. I remember when I was a candidate a couple years back, I was putting some planning together, and I thought, man, it'd be so much easier to focus the attention right here, right in the home district. It wouldn't require as much broad scope thinking. It wouldn't require as much reaching out, as much money to focus the effort. And then the more I thought about that, the more I thought, you know, it might be better as a candidate, but I don't think it's better for the citizens to do that. To me, the greater value was forcing me as a candidate to learn about the rest of this county and to be able to earn that vote and that respect from throughout the county. And then when those decisions are being made, there's a basis of understanding there. There's a basis of learning rather than an easier myopic view. I take another look at this, and I see these really pretty signs that have gone up over this last week or so, red, white, and blue. You know, your vote, your whatever. And I think your loss. There's some good money that's gone in behind these things. And then I hear that some of the development community folks have put up a lot of money to help bring this new thing through, because it would help focus the attention and the money on only three races rather than on five right now. So I think it hurts in the long run.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Moran?
Okay, well, Stan, thank you for the question. That's a good question. I kind of agree with Charlie on this. You're right. I mean, these are four districts that are equally divided by population, okay? So it could very well be that Kent Island will end up having three districts on it. I mean, that all changes over time. Every census, we move the lines. Everybody gets represented equally. You know, to Jack saying, you know, you have the ability to hold five people accountable, I agree. Kent Island has the ability to hold five people accountable. I don't think districts 1, 2, and 3 would have that luxury because they get trumped down here. You know, and Jack, I don't know where you're getting your information on the developers, because Charlie Rhodes right here is the sitting signature on that. So, you know, if you want to start the rumor that this is going to be developers, growth, no growth, we can go there. That's all I got.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Wilson?
Well, you hear a lot of chit-chat about how you're going to have new districts. When's that going to be? We got to get there first. And I don't want to get there through a bad process. Going to go back again. Have you one time heard where the system that's working now went wrong? You've heard only lack of continuity, that when voters change their opinion, the government changed opinion. That's exactly the way democracy is supposed to work. You don't want to be complaining about the very function of it. Jim raises an interesting point. He says the districts are of equal size, but the districts we have in the 2011 last districting we had are in fact not equal size. District 1, as I understand it, and I have heard different sets of numbers, but I believe this is right, has 8,300 people. District 3 has 10,600 or thereabouts. It's 25% bigger. That means that when we have elections, we're going to have to move the district lines back and forth in order to make the districts fair, because in order to have fair representation of the people, each district has to have the same number. But the population over time shifts in the county. And very plainly, we're going to have to move the district lines. Jim said it himself, based on the census, every 10 years. We vote every 4 years. Now, how does that work? How do you move this thing without having the appearance of gerrymandering? How do you move it by registered voters Or maybe do you move it by citizens? Because if you move it by registered voters to the people who are not registered, not have any representation, there are so many questions that are raised by this bad idea that haven't been considered, haven't been settled, haven't been answered, and most particularly, that one about whether the system has worked, and it has.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the gentleman in the back.
My name's Irving Pender. I'm a lifelong resident of Queen Anne's County. I was a former town commissioner in Queenstown and now live outside Centerville. And I have a quick statement and then a quick question. Statement for Mr. Wilson is I'm quite sure that dinosaurs did not evolve into extinction. Extinction happens when people don't change and adapt, and I think that's what we're trying to do with this process. My question is this, is that there was a hearing, a legislative hearing this year, and I was wondering if any of you panel members were at that hearing, and if you voted in opposition to allow the people to at least have the straw vote and have the opportunity to vote this, and what reasoning you had behind that.
Okay, thank you. The order for this one is going to be Mr. Broderick, followed by Mr. Rhodes, then Mr. Wilson, and then Mr. Moran.
Irv, I was not able to make the hearing, but I did provide a written statement to the delegates and the senators stating the opposition that I have to this proposal for reasons I've outlined tonight. And it highlighted the... I've got a copy of the thing I sent right here, but it highlighted the executive and legislative function. It highlighted the ability right now, or the fact that that was developed over an almost two-year period by a county-wide, diverse, broad group, and that it was essentially working. And it provided all Queen Anne's County citizens the opportunity to hold all of their commissioners accountable for their decisions, and recommended that they not vote in favor of this. They did otherwise, but we'll see how the voters operate here in Queen Anne's County.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
Yeah, as I stated earlier, I testified in favor of the legislation, as I did back in 2000 when we had the questions to move from three commissioners to five, and would you rather vote by district rather than large. And back then, both those questions passed during that election. I believe it was close to a 70% voter turnout, and they passed 2-1 here. So not saying that's going to happen here, but we've got two issues as I see it. One is, it's very basic, and that's what myself and the panel that testified, we went up there to vote on the legislation that enables the folks of Queen Anne's County to voice their opinion on this. Not whether it was right or wrong, whether you should have the right to voice your opinion, how you feel about it. Now, I understand there's quite a few people passionate about the issue, and you may be for it, like we are, or you may be against it, like these gentlemen. But we all should be supporting the right of the people to speak on this issue. And, as Jack indicated, whether you're for it or against it, that's why we're having these forums here, not for the Maryland legislature. And I think that's why, because the legislature agreed the people should have the right to speak to it. We got the vote total we did. It was unanimous in both houses.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Wilson?
Well, it was me. I'm the criminal. I went over there, and I said I thought it wasn't a good idea, and I'm going to tell you just why. I think it's very easy to define for the public what district voting is. It's voting confined to your district. That's easy to set out. What is not easy to explain, and it's so difficult to explain that us people here don't really understand it or what the consequences of this are. But that's what the public needs to get informed about. It's not a question of their intelligence or their right. I support both of those. But what they need is an adequate time to be informed, to discuss with their commissioners and amongst themselves, in fact, what the real issues are. In this straw poll, what do we got? A dozen signs out there saying yes, no, 20 people, 50 people in this room, and we're going to have thousands and thousands of voters whose only impression of their informational source is going to be some signs with check marks. And I think that that wasn't a good idea now. To me, the way this should have been done, we should have done this in the general election 2 years from now, and here's why. In the general election, there are 20 debates. There are flyers, there are messaging, there's to-ing and fro-ing between the commissioners and their and the public. And in that process, the public does become informed. They do become aware. I'm not trying to stifle their opinion. I'm trying to add to their awareness in a much broader part, much broader process that would take place in a general election than this travesty of putting up a question that we know all of us can't even decide what the consequences of the darn thing are. And we need the public to know what it is they're changing when they're changing a system which has been working and which I haven't really heard why it isn't working yet.
Okay, thank you. Let's see, Mr. Moran.
Okay. Well, Mr. Wilson keeps saying he doesn't hear, you know, why we need to change him. I'll say it one more time. So the representatives, so the individuals that live in districts 1, 2, and 3 can finally know that their vote will count and they will get somebody that will represent them that won't be trumped by the other districts. See if you can stay with that one. You know, with as far as the Senate is concerned and the House, I agree. I mean, we went down there. We went down there to ask for them for their blessing so that we could get this on the ballot so we could hear from the citizens of Queen Anne's County. I said this in Sudlersville. If the citizens of Queen Anne's County say, no, we don't want to change, I'm fine with that. The citizens are the one making a choice, not the select few that want to kill this. Don't even want us to talk about it. Don't even want us to vote about it. This was done 6 months ago. 6 months. So if you're in opposition to this, you had 6 months to come out here and educate the public. You didn't do anything. You waited till the last month. And as far as these glossy signs, what do we have in an election? Signs everywhere. Glossy mailers. Never meet anybody, but you read everything, you see all the signs, and you make your decision from that. So I guess our the way we elect everybody is flawed. I think that you know, hearing what the people want is the most democratic way we could go. Thank you.
Okay, gentlemen.
My name is Mark Nitkoski. I live in Chester, and I have an opinion regarding this. And I do not consider myself a person from just one district. I consider myself a member of this county. And I believe that the people should vote across the board for the county simply because we need broad-minded people, not narrow-minded. My real question here is, and this is what I'm hearing and I don't understand it, I don't think anyone is currently disenfranchised. One man, one vote. If you give an outsized directive that allows a smaller group to trump a larger group, the majority no longer rules. And I think majority rules is what democracy is about. Who has the most votes wins. So I don't like the idea of allocating that. My real question is, can you name one man or one good woman in this county that was not elected because they lived in Stevensville or Chestertown? We're going to vote good people in, no matter where they come from.
Okay, thank you. Order on this is Mr. Moran, followed by Mr. Wilson, then Mr. Rhodes, and Mr. Broderick.
Well, that's a hard question. I wish I had. If we had a list, I'd like to look at the list and see who it was. But I agree with you. I don't have a problem with what you just said. I agree with them. But my point is, everybody can vote on the at-large. Everybody can vote on the at-large. So everybody, it will be the will of the entire county. But I don't think it's right that a larger voting block can outweigh a smaller voting block that we have in districts 1, 2, and 3. And that's what this is about. You have a very good point there. And I would hope that if the individual that gets elected in 1, 2, and 3 is broad-minded, you know, I mean, just because you're representing a district doesn't mean you throw a blind eye to the rest of the county. That's ridiculous. Senator Hershey is our district, but he's looking at everything across the county. He votes on everything across the county. So I don't think that is a reason not to say vote by district. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Wilson?
Well, I think a larger voting block should outweigh a smaller voting block. I mean, come on. Isn't that what voting is about? It's called a majority. And that's what we want to stick with. And this gentleman, I thought, spoke so eloquently. I can't improve on that. He was absolutely right. This thing should be done by the majority of the people. The fact that at times smaller groups don't have their will is unfortunate. But the key thing in this is that the greater will of the largest number of people be fairly represented by those they elect. And the way the system is now, that's what's happened. If we change it, it's going to be not so good.
Thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
And I agree with both these gentlemen. It's a tough question to answer. Of course, I don't have a list in front of all the candidates that have run since I've been here in Queen Anne's County. But I honestly believe if we vote by district, which, as I understand it, by federal law, those districts, based on every census, have to have about the equal number of population, give or take 5%, I think it's still the law, is the way to go. I think you're going to elect, as Commissioner Moran indicated, we as a group are going to elect fair-minded people that will represent their district as well as look out for the best interests of the county. And you're going to get a more diverse, in my view, Board of County Commissioners. I think I mentioned it the last time, debate, if you will, is that right now, with voting everybody at large, in theory, all commissioners should represent me in Church Hill. But I've had in previous boards where I've gone to the commissioner in 3-4 about a problem up there, and I'm referred to the commissioner in District 1. So we're already doing it to a certain degree. And I just think if we change the election process to what the question speaks to, I think we're going to get a better product.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Broderick?
Yeah, I think you stated my concerns quite eloquently. Thank you. I think it is a matter of broad thinking, of accountability across the county. You know, I've heard we got to have faith that under the new system, the commissioner from somewhere else will make the right decision. We got to have hope. I haven't heard love yet, but you know, we're getting there. I think it really comes out of that category into accountability, and that's where I would come. These are hard, tough political decisions that have to be made, and we've got to have countywide accountability. Thanks.
Good. Thank you. I have one more question, and I know you've put your hand up, so come on up.
Thank you all for coming today. My name is Helen Bennett, and I live in Chester. I've just been here for two elections, so 2010 and 2014. And I do want to say I've stayed with it, Mr. Moran. I'm following you. And just as you said that Hershey, he looks after everybody in Queen Anne's County, and you talk about accountability, I know that I've been trying to reach a commissioner for the last 2 weeks who's not my district commissioner. And it's been a challenge. If he's not going to call me back or reach out to me, and he's not in my commission, how much more is he not going to be motivated to call me back when I don't even get to say in whether he's elected or not? Because it's something, you know, every commissioner, depending on what district they're in, can introduce things that will affect my district. And I would like to be able to ask questions and get informed.
Your question is?
Well, I'm getting there with the accountability. Yep. I'm sorry, thank you. And the Wheatlands, you know, you can't say whether or not it would have happened if we had had the same district voting by district. You can't say that. You have no idea. It's like the traffic studies that we have all the time. You can't say that. But why would you think that if you think it's broken, why would not staggered elections, open primaries, or encouraging people to get out and vote would make more of a difference than this? Because 36 votes is what separated a couple of these candidates, and that's 0.002% of the population that's eligible to vote in Queen Anne's County.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. The order on this is Mr. Wilson, Mr. Moran, Mr. Broderick, and Mr. Rhodes.
Once again, you said it. You're right. I think that you get the response from commissioners the best when they are getting reelected by you. It certainly makes a greater distance between the public and their representative when it's not their representative. And you find in the actual doing of government, a fact which it's not really perceptible from the outside, but Mr. Moran and I think would agree about this. Certain commissioners specialize or have particular interests in certain things. He's been very interested and absolutely active and good in drugs and looking after kids' backpacks. He's an absolutely excellent commissioner and involved, honest, decent, good man. I do something a little different, and I'm not honest or decent. I'm more interested in finance and the infrastructure of the county, so that if somebody were to call up and know that, they might appeal to me being interested in roads. Any commissioner has equal effect on the employees of the county, but certain commissioners do tend to specialize in certain things. And I think that balkanizing the county so that the individual commissioners are only responsible to that district plainly put more of a gulf between the representative and what's actually getting done.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Moran?
I'm trying to kind of perplexed at what your question was, but you know, apparently you don't have, there's a commissioner you're trying to reach now that hasn't returned your calls under this system. And are you saying under the other system you'd only be able to call yours and not the other ones?
No, my question was why you felt that this is the answer to being accountable and having a better system rather than open primaries or getting people to just vote, because only 11% of the people that are eligible to vote voted in the primaries. I guess I'm thinking, why do you think that this was the answer? If it was just because someone won by 36 votes or lost by 36 votes, doesn't seem a compelling reason to change it to this when there's all these other options.
Okay, available. Great. Thank you. Well, I think it is. It's a compelling reason for District 1, 2, and 3. I think that it is. I think that those are the districts, once again, that are feeling that they are not fairly represented. And when I say that, I mean, you know, we all know that there's different groups and different organizations that endorse candidates. We all know that the candidates form slates, and we all get that. So, I mean, you know, there's a whole bunch of different arrays of why somebody gets elected. All I'm saying is just to keep it where each district has a representative. That's
three is bigger than four.
Well, and I'll get to that in my closing arguments, but that's another story in itself.
Okay. Mr. Broderick?
Ellen, I just agree with your concern totally. It's that accountability thing. If you have no ability at all to elect three of the people that run your government, how in the heck are you going to get them, other than through maybe faith and hope? How are you going to get them to be responsive to you? Personally, I'm not willing to go down that road. I really think we've got such critical decisions coming up facing the whole county, particularly this area here. We need to hold our decision makers, our leaders, accountable for those decisions.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Rhodes?
Yes, ma'am. You indicated about several other methods that we might be able to, I guess, address some of these issues that have been raised by some of the citizens. And for those of you that don't know, there was a second part to, or a second question that was introduced in the legislature, and it was staggered terms. And for whatever reason, the legislature decided not to move on that, which could, maintain some continuity, where you wouldn't be voting for all your commissioners at the same time. But having said that, I think, and again, having watched this process since the late 90s, and having testified on the legislation in 2000 that helped establish where we are today, I think this is an evolution in that process. And if in fact we were to move in this direction, it will be an improvement on what we had. Because I can tell you, back then, there were many of us that thought, well, attended the meetings, wasn't appointed to the commission. But it looked like we thought there were going to be five equal districts with a population of 8,500 to 9,000 at the time, based on the 2000 census tract. And in fact, at the time, the commissioners voted for the board, the president of the board. And that's where we thought it was going to go, but obviously it didn't happen that way. But I believe, in fact, that just like you, and of course, I don't want to ask you the question, is your, well, the question would be, is your commissioner in your district responsible to you now?
Yes, I reached out to him the next day.
Right. And but I think if, in fact, we were had individual districts and we voted by district, your individual commissioner would be more, you know, more accountable to you, just like would the rest of the county.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I had seen other hands that were up, but unfortunately, we're getting to the bewitching hour here. And what I'd like to do then is ask each of our participants are going to be giving their two-minute closing remarks or summarizing remarks. And the order for this will start out with Mr. Rhodes, then Mr. Broderick, then Mr. Moran, and then Mr. Wilson.
Again, I want to thank the League of Women Voters for having the opportunity to speak and share my thoughts with the folks down here in District 4. And there's no doubt where I stand on the issue. And there should be no doubt, you know, where the Council of Government stands, because it's been publicized twice about the votes and the reasons why. The main thing is, like I say, I wholeheartedly believe that the people should have the right to speak on this question. So I encourage everyone, obviously, to vote, let your feelings be known, and then however it shakes out, it shakes out. Maybe it's time to move to a new direction, which I believe it is. We've attempted the current system, as I stated earlier. Out of the 17 people that have served, not including these five here since we've done it, only one was returned by the voter. And I think that's been detrimental to the county. And like I say, your vote, it's a straw poll. It's not binding on the sitting commissioners, but it'll be an indicator of whether they should make a change, don't make a change, or do nothing. I think it's time to move forward, continue with the evolution that we started back in 2000.
Good. Thank you. Mr. Broderick?
Thank you to the League for putting this together. Thanks to all of you for coming tonight, and thanks to our citizenry that are watching on Queen Anne's TV. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. I don't think it's broken right now. I think we could break it quite badly by taking a giant step backwards. Again, strongly looking at the dual role of our Queen Anne's County commissioners, both legislative and executive. All of us now have the ability to hold all of them accountable for both of those critical functions. I think we ought to continue to be able to hold all of them accountable. To only hold two accountable would be a giant step backwards. And I urge all of you, again, that are watching, that are going to be voting, please think twice and don't fall for this. Vote against this proposal. Stay on the track we're on and hold our leaders accountable. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Moran?
Okay, well, first, I don't have a problem with what Jack says, but I understand Jack says that because that's District 4. And the votes are trumping District 1, 2, and 3. So they're able to hold everybody accountable. Districts 1, 2, and 3, they don't have that option. And that's what I want to bring. I want to bring it so that everybody can hold two people accountable. I'd rather hold two people accountable than nobody accountable. So, you know, that's what this is about. As far as the districts, you know, the county now has GIS mapping. We can move a line at a snap of a finger. So it's not a major throw. Census every 10 years to do it is not a major issue. You know, each boundary we set the same. The state does it. It's not a major issue. School-age children for the last 3 years, has dropped. Our population isn't growing out of control. We need to change it every 4 years. We've been at 48,000, 49,000 for like the last 10 years. So again, we're not busting at the seams here. And you know, again, I mean, accountability is important. It's important to the people in District 1, 2, and 3 also. And, you know, I think that to that statement, if you can spend $80,000 to $100,000, why can't you win your district? That's all we want. We just want you to win your district and move on from there. I mean, and it's got to be easier if you only got to go in one district versus going in all five, because it's a challenge. So, again, you know, I support this. I think it's, you know, it's good for Queen Anne's County, and it's good for the upper part of the county, and it's fair for everybody. It's equal for everybody. It's the same vote in District 1 as it is in District 4. Nobody's getting ahead of anybody. It's fair representation. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Wilson.
Big bad District 4. How the hell did they get it all? I mean, that's rubbish. I mean, really. District 4 has had no advantage over District 2, 3, or 1. In fact, District 4, let me tell you something. I am the person that kind of assembles a lot of the finance numbers in the county. District 4 produces $36 million worth of taxable income if you combine property and income tax. District 1 produces $18 million. There's a massive transfer of wealth from District 4 down to District 1. It's not that they're not getting their feelings expressed. They're actually getting a tremendous benefit from a system that's shared equally amongst all the citizens, so that the roads were fair, the schools were fair, the kids were fair, the ambulances were fair. That's what's happened. What you're talking about here is something that's going to balkanize the county, and if District 4 wants to get its way and be piggy about it, District 1 is going to close a school, because the system is working extremely well now. One thing, you continue that, go back to it again, you have heard no sort of list of things where, as government has rolled on over the years, services or the resources of the county were misdistributed, because they haven't been. So to change that to a system which is plainly not, even as far as I'm concerned, flawed, much less broken, would be a very, very poor idea. And finally, the idea that District 1, 2, and 3 don't get their opinion expressed is utterly nonsense. We, all of us, each of us have a vote. We're all of us voting, and sometimes 1 and 2 get a vote together, and sometimes 3 or 4. It goes which way? There's never been any bias in this regard. This is a completely fake argument, so I beg you to stay on course here, guys.
Okay, well, thank you. This concludes this evening's forum, and I would just like you to join me in thanking our speakers here. Okay, thank you. And thank you all for coming. Excellent questions.